The secret of the mysterious 10x minus x proof. In this video, for the first time ever, we will get to the bottom of what's really going on in this proof, and all of its secrets will finally be revealed. You will usually see this proof performed using decimal notation, but the decimal notation represents a series of rational values, and it's claimed that this proof shows how this particular series of rational values all add up to the single rational value of 1. And so for extra clarity, we will perform the proof by explicitly showing the rational values. So now let's do the 10x minus x proof with the rational values. Here we start with x equals the series 9 tenths plus 9 hundredths plus 9 thousandths and so on. We form the next line by simply multiplying throughout by 10. So we have 10x on one side, and on the other side, the first term is 90 over 10. This simplifies to just 9. The next term is 90 over 100. And that simplifies to 9 tenths, and we've got 9 tenths already on the line above. So what we do is, we shift terms along to line up the like-for-like terms. Next, we subtract the first line from the second line. So, on the left-hand side, we have 10x subtract x, gives 9x. We go on to the next term, and we've got 90 over 10, which is just 9, take away 0. And this leaves just 9. Now we've reached the start of the terms that we've lined up on purpose because they have the same value. As we said before, 90 over 100 equals 9 tenths. So when we subtract one from the other, we get 0. And the same can be said for all subsequent terms. They will all cancel out completely. So there's nothing more to include on the next line, leaving this 9x equals 9 as a result of our subtraction. This simplifies to x equals 1. And since we started with the series 9 tenths plus 9 hundredths and so on, we appear to have shown that the series of terms all adds up to 1. The only possible bone of contention here concerns the part of the subtraction highlighted in yellow. The first line has all terms of the series in this yellow area. But the second line does not have the first term of the series in the yellow area, so it could be said to have all terms minus 1, lining up with all terms from the first line. So in order to verify that this result of the subtraction is valid, we need to know, can we really compare all terms with all terms minus 1 and expect them all to cancel out nicely? Is it valid to assume we can? What we have here is a multiply, shift and subtract method. It applies to structures called geometric series. And 0.9 recurring is one of these geometric series, which means there's a common ratio between the terms. The general form of a geometric series is shown here. A is the first term, and R is the common ratio. So the first term is just A on its own, the second term is AR, and so on. And a simple way to calculate R is to divide the second term of the series by the first. In order to analyse the 10x minus x proof, we need to think about what's going on in terms of the A and R of a geometric series. Specifically, we need to describe this result of the subtraction in algebraic form. So we need to focus on understanding how we get this result of the subtraction. We can't go to infinity to check that all the terms cancel out, but what we can do is consider the possibility that they might not all cancel out. And then we can produce an algebraic expression for that scenario. So let's play devil's advocate. Let's dare to think that we might not really be able to do maths with actual infinities. We can still allow any number of terms to cancel out, but we can't allow infinitely many terms to cancel out. This means a subtraction can cancel out any finite number of terms, but not all of them. Let's see what this means with regards to the 10x minus x proof. Remember, we can only cancel out a finite number of terms. Again, we start with the series, but we describe it with respect to the nth term. So the nth term is 9 over 10 to the power n, and we have endless terms after the nth term. On the next line, we multiply throughout by 10 and we line up the terms that will cancel out. We can see that in total, n minus 1 terms will cancel out. And so the result of the subtraction is this. And by dividing both sides by 9, it simplifies to this result. The first two terms effectively give us the sum of the first n terms in our original series. And then the rest of the terms are just the terms after the nth term in our original series. So the difference between this and the original proof is that the original proof discards all these trailing terms on the basis that infinitely many terms will cause them to cancel out. What we want to do is generalize the result of the subtraction, which is this line. We want to express this line in a general algebraic form that's valid for any geometric series. We end up with two different algebraic expressions for the two scenarios we're considering. In the case we've just seen, where only a finite number of terms cancel out, we get this expression. Whereas in the original proof, where we assume all terms cancel out, we get this expression. 1 minus r times the original series equals the first term of the original series. This agrees with the notion of convergence. If we divide throughout by 1 minus r, we get the textbook formula for the sum of a geometric series. Now let's consider the simple geometric series, where the first term is 1 and the common ratio is also 1. Expression 1 reduces to 0 equals 0 for any value of n. This result seems quite reasonable. Expression 2 reduces to 0 equals 1. This is a clear contradiction. If we examine the two expressions, they both have the same left-hand side, and they both produce different results for the same input values, so they cannot both be valid. As we've seen here, expression 2 results in a contradiction. So we have to conclude that the argument in the 10x minus x proof that all the trailing terms cancel out is an invalid argument. Does this make sense? Well, algebraically, all geometric series are the same. So when A and R are both non-zero, every term in the series will be non-zero, such as in the example where A and R are both 1. In this example, it's easy to see that however many terms we account for, there will always be an endless stream of non-zero terms that we have not accounted for. We cannot sum to a constant value, and so the mathematical contradiction on the previous slide does make sense, because endless non-zero terms summing to a constant is a logical absurdity. But in our head, we have a brain, and this gives us an ability called imagination. Using this, we can imagine that endless non-zero terms can equal a constant, despite the mathematical contradiction and the logical absurdity. We can imagine this as long as the common ratio makes the terms get progressively smaller. We even give this imagination a name. We call it convergence. Then we reinforce this idea by accepting arguments for convergence that use infinity, such as the construction of so-called real numbers using Cauchy sequences or Dedekind cuts. So let's consider what this result means. It means endless non-zero terms cannot sum to a constant. It means the textbook formula for the sum of a geometric series is totally invalid. It means the 10x minus x proof is invalid. It means the series 0.9 recurring cannot equal 1. And it doesn't matter if the value of the terms gets smaller, bigger, flips between positive and negative values, or whatever, they cannot converge to a constant value. The algebra shows us that the concept of convergence is nothing more than self-delusion. And as the idea that endless non-zero rational values can sum to a constant is a logical absurdity that demonstrably leads to contradiction for all geometric series, there is no valid reason to believe that the concept of real numbers is in any way a valid concept. This begs the question, is 0.9 recurring a number? Not if we define a number to be a constant value. But if we really want to include endless series in our definition of a number, then we could express constants in terms of a series. So the constant 1 would be the series where the nth sum is 1. And 0.9 recurring is a different number because it has a different nth sum. And halfway between 1 and 0.9 recurring, we have this series. So if an endless series is a number, we can easily find numbers between 0.9 recurring and 1. That's all well and good, and we know that 0.9 recurring cannot be a constant. But then how can we describe what it really means? Well, one option is to think of the notation as shorthand for an algorithm that describes how to construct an endless series. The algorithm consists of a finite number of lines, 4 in this case. It can be said to be endless in that it describes a process where no endpoint is defined. In step 4, it says to jump back to step 2, and so there's no instruction that says stop the process. We may have used this in the past, and we may use it many times in the future, but however many times we use it, it will always be a finite number of times. Every time it's used, the machine or person following the algorithm can only go around the loop a finite number of times. So even though the algorithm can be described as endless, every single aspect of it is finite. In fact, endlessness is always entirely finite. So the statement, infinite means endless, is a complete contradiction in terms. This video is brought to you by extremefinitism.com. Please show your support by becoming a patron at patreon.com/karmapini.